When you're reading the Bible, if it repeats itself, it's like a big sign saying, pay attention, listen to what I'm saying. Luke 15 is a great chapter in the Bible. And it essentially tells three stories that are basically the same story. The story of the lost sheep, the story of the lost coin, and the story of the lost son. So it not only repeats itself, but it repeats itself again. But as always, I want to remind you also of context. The context of Luke 15. Luke 15 follows Luke 14, which says something along the lines of, if you want to be my disciple, you need to give up your life and follow me. You need to take up your cross and follow me. You need to love me and care about me and what I care about, God says, so much that your love for your family, your parents, your children, your spouse, dim in comparison to your love for me. God says, essentially, I want you all in for me. And then he says, the story of the lost sheep, the lost coin, and the lost son. Now that's not the only context. There's another context there as well. It's the context of the Pharisees and the teachers of religious law not liking the fact that Jesus is hanging around tax collectors and sinners. Riffraff. Undesirables. People with bad reputations. And so Jesus' stories are an answer to their accusation. I like this cartoon. God calls his people sheep. One sheep says to another, that's a compliment, right? What else could it mean? Ah, ignorance is bliss. My very first church, when I was talking with the call committee, had the president of the church on the call committee. And they asked me what image of a pastor I thought of and referred to. And I made the mistake of saying shepherd. Because his immediate response was, so you think we're a bunch of stupid sheep, huh? I think he was trying to get a rise out of me. I stayed calm and I got the call. But I will tell you, when I think of the lost sheep, I do think of things like my dogs. I mean, the reason they're lost is because they're stupid. It's because they get distracted and they wander away, and the darn sheep was disobedient. If he had stayed with the herd, if he had followed the lead sheep with the bell or whatever it is, you know, he would have been fine. But no, he's got to go wandering off on his own, doing his own thing, thinking that the grass is greener on the other side, and the sheep gets lost. So when the story says that the shepherd will leave the 99 and look for that stupid lost sheep, there's an element of forgiveness, I guess, in it, right? I mean, after all, the sheep probably deserves a little bit of lostness. But you know, there's something wrong with the stupid sheep that's lost. Very often when the shepherd finds that sheep, the sheep doesn't even know he's lost. The darn sheep hasn't found grass greener on the other side and is just having the time of his life, just eating away at the grass. And that shepherd goes and picks him up, throws him on his shoulders, and brings back, oh yeah, I know, the Bible commentary says that's to show that the shepherd is caring for the sheep. I think it's so that the sheep won't just run back to the grass. You see, what I'm portraying to you is this thing in me that is experiencing frustration or anger or maybe just irritation at the sheep. I want to point the finger of blame on the sheep. But God says he's going to go all out. I was talking to Kevin Merrill the other Sunday, a couple of weeks ago. He had been out the night before because Tucson had called and asked his crew if they would go out on a search and rescue mission. Apparently, that's not a completely unusual thing. But Kevin, being the lead person in that, you know, has to call around. He has to get the team together. And there's a sense of urgency. We've got to do that quickly, and we got to get out there, and we've got to find that lost person. Because they're important, because they matter, because they are probably hurt, and the longer it takes, it's possible, the more danger they're in. And so they gather the team together. They make a concerted effort to go and find and search for and rescue that one who is lost. Sometimes they know. They know the person has fallen. They know the person has been injured. Other times, they're just missing. But there's a sense of urgency that says we need to help, because that person's important. Then when you see that, often the person searching has to put themselves in danger for that which is lost. This image of the shepherd on the screen, the shepherd is climbing down this cliff to grab that sheep on that precarious place. Seen some television shows lately where the rescuers go down on a rope and they tie the other person up as the car is teetering on the edge. And, you know, as Hallmark movies can be, they unhook their own rope. Rescuers, no, they're not supposed to do that, but Hallmark hasn't figured that out. And then they tie the person on, and just as they tie the person on, the car falls. And the person somehow slides through the window as the car falls. And even though you think they've fallen because the camera flashed away just as the car went flat, then the rope tightens up and slowly but surely they both are rescued over the top of the cliff. Ah, tears come to my eyes. And I'm reminded what a wimp I am. But we do that. Part of the reason we have such deep respect for our service personnel in the fire department and police department and for our soldiers who go and put themselves in harm's way is because they will put themselves in harm's way. They've made a commitment to sacrifice themselves for us, to take risks, to be sure that we are safe and okay, and we honor them for that. And we're grateful to them for that. Let's think about this story of the lost coin for a moment. If a coin is lost, is it any less valuable than the one that's still in your pocket? Well, one might argue, well, yes, it's less valuable to you because you can't use it if you don't have it. But the fact that the coin is lost doesn't make it any less valuable. And a part of the reason the woman will turn on the lamp at night and sweep out the whole house looking for that lost coin is because that lost coin has value. Now, the difference between the lost coin and the lost sheep is you can't blame a coin for being lost. I really wanted Jesus to flip this around. I think Luke got it wrong. I think Luke should have put the lost coin first, and then the lost sheep, and then the lost son, because then there would have been an appropriate progression of blame. But I think the reason Jesus told the story of the lost coin after the story of the lost sheep is he wanted to say to the people, stop worrying about blame and instead see value in that which is lost. And more importantly, see that the shepherd, the one who owns the coin, see that God values that which is lost. Because you see, when we're blaming, when we're judging, when we look and go, you know, it's your own darn fault you're in this mess anyway, we tend to somehow in our hearts and minds either think or project on others that they're less valuable because it's their fault, that they're less cared for because it's their fault. And I think Jesus is saying unambiguously in this story that he sees value in those who are lost. They've lost no value because they're far away, and he will do whatever it takes to bring them back. You know the story of the prodigal son. I mean, if any time we're going to have a chance to blame, it's in this story. You know, when the son asks for his inheritance, he's essentially saying to the father, I wish you were dead. Give me my money so I can go live my life. And then when he squanders it all and he comes back and the father's arms are open wide, meets him on the road, doesn't even let him get his apology out before he's sending off the servants to get the nice robe and put a ring on his finger and to let him know he still belongs in this family. It's a powerful story of grace. And if you're a prodigal, I hope you'll see the heart of God in this story. That he's waiting and watching and ready to receive you home, to clean you up, to throw a party and a feast to fill you, to recognize you as his son by putting the coat and the ring on you and say, I love you. I couldn't love you any more than I do right now. These three stories of the lost sheep, the lost coin, and the lost son are stories of grace. They're stories of forgiveness. They're stories that tell us that God loves us. But it's not all good news. I want to make sure that we hear in this story that it's not all good news. In our Old Testament lesson today, where God is saying through the prophet that he's going to seek those who have been scattered, it also says he's going to hold accountable those who have not helped them. He's going to judge between the fat and the skinny, those with resources and those that are living their lives in scarcity. And the implication is that those who have been living their lives with resources that haven't helped those who are hungry are in trouble. You see, when you love someone, then you don't like it when someone hurts those you love. If we don't respond in love to those whom God loves, we put ourselves in jeopardy. Now, I'm grateful that the New Testament is slightly less thorough in its condemnation as the Old Testament. Because in the New Testament, we see the father respond to the older son. You see, the older son is upset with dad because dad had the audacity to throw a party to that wayward, good-for-nothing little brother that made his life more difficult. And why, after all, hasn't dad thrown a party for him? He's the faithful son, after all. He was angry. He wouldn't join the party. And his father came out and begged him and replied, "All these years," the son said, "I've slaved for you and never once refused to do a single thing you told me. And in all that time, you never even gave me one young goat for a feast with my friends. Yet when this son of yours comes back squandering your money on prostitutes, you celebrated by killing the fatted calf, the best calf." It's not fair. What about me? And the father says, "Don't you see? This son of yours was lost. This brother of yours was lost. And now he's found. He was dead. But now he's alive. And we have to rejoice. We have to celebrate. This is great news." And you see, there's the party of the prodigal son is matched by the party that happens in heaven with the angels when one person far from God is returned. When one person who's drifted away and is lost is brought back, that angels in heaven rejoice. And I want to say to you, Desert Hope, that we have a job to do. We need to be the cause of some parties in heaven. We need to make the angels happy by allowing God to put his heart of love and concern for those who are far from him in us, so that we will respond like the good shepherd, so that we will respond like the woman who lost the coin, so that we will respond like the father and seek those who are far from God to welcome them home and welcome them back. Please pray for me, with me. Lord, give us a love for those who are far from you. Let us as a church and as individuals be used so that we might be an inspiration for the angels of heaven to rejoice. Amen.